Praise the Lord. I want to congratulate everybody who is graduating this year and going past to different ventures. And Naveen is going to middle school, new school for him also. So everybody is going through a different stage of life. So Abraham Lincoln says that, "I've been driven many times to my knees by the overwhelming conviction that I have nowhere else to go." It talks about praying. Whatever happens, you pray. So that's what it is for the graduates. That the thing is that you are graduating, you have too much to now, new ventures, new life, new ahead, lot of stuff. Maybe you have heard this story when, it's a old story, when a missionary after many years in Africa was coming back to US, he was on a ship, and when the ship landed in the port, the ship had the president of this country, you know, I think it was Ted Roosevelt who was there. So when he saw that, a lot of people came to greet the president. So he came out, there was nobody, he was alone. So he called God that, "I did everything to you. I sacrificed all my life. I planted too many seeds for you in Africa, but I have nowhere." So the voice came from inside, is that, "My dear, this is not your home yet." So we think that we can gain a lot of our life, but this is not our home. Today I'm going to talk about talk from the verse Psalms 73, book of Psalms 73. It's Asaph wrote this. I want to read particularly Psalms 73, verse 21 to 26. If you open,
"When my heart was grieved and my spirit embittered, I was senseless and ignorant. I was a brute beast before you. Yet I am always in you. You hold me by my right hand. You guide me with your counsel, and afterwards you will be glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? And the earth has nothing I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever."
Thank you. And also I will read one more verse just for that to it, Philippians 4:8. "Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent and all praises, think about such things." So let me talk about back to that verse. You know, bitterness, today I'm talking about bitterness and anger. And you have two choices, bitterness or betterment, or anger or happiness. So bitterness or angerness is simply the absence of betterment of God. You know, so it's the absence of it. So when we focus more on noble truth, godliness, kindness, the bitterment will be there. So I will come with an analogy. It's kind of, I like science a lot, to talk about science in this kind of context. So I will come with an analogy. One time a teacher in a class was telling the students, like, do you believe that God made everything? So they said, "Yes, we believe God made everything." So did you believe that if God made everything, okay, so what somebody makes, everything comes from them, that means God made evil. So he said, so he was like, "Good. That means God is evil." So the kid didn't respond. So the teacher said, "Yeah, he's pretty happy with what he said. Like, they were not responding. That means Christianity is a myth." After like a few minutes later, one boy raised his hand, says that, "May I ask you something, sir?" So he says, so he stood up and said, "Is there such thing as cold?" So he's like, "What do you mean, cold? Like, yeah, have you not been cold? So okay, let me ask you, what is cold? What is cold?" very heat. Okay. The cold is the absence of heat. You know? So if you think about it, you know, actually cold doesn't exist. You know, there's no cold. Like, if you think through it, we have winter, right? So why is winter we have? Because the sun is farther from the earth. So we have less heat, so there's cold, you know. So basically cold doesn't exist. So we have only created this term cold because to say that there is no heat, so there is cold. So there is something called absolute zero. You know, what's an absolute zero? If anybody in science, it says -273 degrees Kelvin. That's the coldness you can have. That's called there is no heat. Okay. So the boy didn't finish. He said, "Do you know, sir, there's such thing as darkness?" He said, "Of course there's a darkness." Okay. So again he says, "There's no such thing as darkness. The absence of light is darkness." So like when there's no light, there's darkness. You know, one of my favorite quote, I always say, it's better to light a candle than shout at the darkness. So he continued, "Is there such thing as evil?" So what is it? What are you talking about? Evil? Of course there's evil. We can see murders, like we 2 days back, the boy shooting, violence everywhere. There is evil. So he says, "Actually, sir, there is much thing. There is no such thing as evil. Evil is simply the absence of God. Evil is a term we made it to describe the absence of God. God did not create evil. It's not like truth or love. When there's love, truth or love, it's like heat and light. When there's no there, there is evil. It's like cold or darkness." Professor had, the teacher had nothing to say. Let me come back to what Asa was talking about. Let's talk about Asa. He was a musician in the David's court. So he wrote lyrics for the song. So Psalms he wrote. In that he talks about, he was a choir director. If you think about it, the presence of the temple, he's a kind of an okay guy. And if you think about it, he was a prophet. If you look back in Chronicles, they talk him about with David, he's kind of a prophet. And then he raised good kids also. Like his kids went with the, it says that he walked with the God like that. It's a small verse he talks about. So he was a good man. But still, he was driven by jealousy and envy. If you go back on the same chapter, 3 to 12, he talks about that. He talks about why all the people who are bad at everything, right? He's complaining that people who are, like we have seen in our life also, we say people are so successful. They didn't do nothing good in their life. They're so successful. They have good cars. And the same thing is happening with Asa. He's talking about the bitterness he's getting from people around him, like who are, they never did anything good in their life and they are getting everything. Like he talks about why he's not getting it. Like, you know, he started complaining. He talks about then, and so we have also, he's struggling with the society's things. He's not, the problem with us is that in our own life, we don't think through it. But he's a choir director in the David. Brought his well off, still he's complaining because he can't find, other people are much well off than me, okay? They're bad people, so why should I not be them? Like, why should I not go that much? That's a problem. We compare ourselves with others. And that, it's just like sometimes we compare, like my kid, like, did you get 90% time? Oh, you got 90, oh no, I went there more than 95 kid. So that's it. And I'm like, that's like you got 90, man. Like your parents compared, that's like your happiness gone, right? So we always, as a parent also, as a kid, like we compare. That's why our happiness goes up. We take out that's like, and it says that In Hebrews 12:15, he says, "See that no one misses the grace of God, and that no bitter root grow up to cause trouble and define me." So I want to tell you a small story. I like to tell stories because I feel like stories have more. So this farmer had a farmland, and he used to complain that his lake had, he has to always thin his fishes. That means too many fishes were there in his lake, so he had to take out the fishes. Then he used to complain about the hills made him to, like, it's putting the fence was difficult. The curved hills made him putting fence difficult. Then he was talking about because of his, he had such a big land, he cannot see his cows. Then he says about his from the barn in the night to walk to his house, it was too dark. He said, "This is no good place. I should sell this place." So he called his real estate agent and said, "I want to sell this land. I feel like it's no good for me." So after a couple of weeks, he saw a listing in the newspaper about the land. He says that this land is on sale. It is on a pristine lake filled with bass, having very slopy, beautiful hills with Angus beef cows, and then beautiful classic barn with a side of flowers and soft grass, and very near to the town but not that close to the city life, so it's, you're up out of city's noise, very close to, convenient to the town to buy. Said, "Wow, this is a nice place." He had to read it twice. Then he found that that was his own listing. So problem is that we always find the something else better than what we have. And the problem is, in our success to reach higher ground, we are ready to go through any means. So as like people, like you're graduating, you're going through college, and you have to go through something like in work environments and all, why I cannot be like him, not be in my own ways, you know. The thing is that the problem is that we say that, it says John 14:12 says, "He who believes in me, the work I will do, he will also, and he also do greater work than that he will do, because I go to the Father. You can ask anything in my name and I will do it." The problem is that we don't see God. We seek God. If you seek God, he will give you the direction. The problem is we seek our own thought process. That's why it says that Psalms 100 says that, it's like all the time sing daily, it says, talks about. If you're with presence of God all the time, this bitterness and anger will not come through you. This is it says that about God, that later on, Asaph talks about how God gave him the strength, stability, and the sustenance because he worshipped him. He talks about the bitterness, then he talks about, if you go back to the verse we read, he says that, "I was senseless and ignorant, I was a brute, bees before you, yet I always was with you. You hold me in my right hand. You guided me with your counsel." God gives us the counsel. "And then afterward, you will take me to your glory." He talks about the glory. It's in our life, we always are in so much, we are so short-sighted. We don't see the long-sightedness. It's the thing, for that, I want to add something else, is that our life, the whole thing can be summarized in Psalms 23. You know that, our present God. So let me read in a way so it talks about, "The Lord is my shepherd." That's the relationship. I shall not want. That's a supply. You get everything. "He leadeth beside still water." That's the refreshment. "He restoreth my soul." That's the healing. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness. That's the guidance. "For his name's sake." That's the purpose. "If I walk through the valley of shadow of death," that's the testing in your life. "I fear no evil." That's the protection. And thou art with me, that's the faithfulness. Thou rod and thy staff that comfort me, that's the discipline. And thou prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. That's the hope. Thou anoint my head with oil. That's the consecration. My cup runneth over. That's abundance. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me throughout my life. That's the blessing. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord. That's security forever. That's eternity. God says, in the end, I will start with some Billy Graham's talks about 10 Christian livings. First, he starts with read Bible daily. If you have the words in your hand, if you have words, you have everything. You know the Bible. That's not reading like you just read it, but deal with it daily. Then says that learn to have no secret prayer. How to know prayer? He talks about communicating with God through prayer. He can accomplish anything. The third he talks about rely constantly on the Holy Spirit. So he's like, we know that Holy Spirit, he can comfort us through our darkest time. He says, attend church regularly. Because church is a very important in life. People around the church can make us grow. And he says, be a witness to Christ. We have to witness two ways, by how you lead the right life and by the words. We can be witnessed by the word. We should always just by life as well as the word. And he says that, let love be the ruling principle of your life. God says that your love is the thing. By this shall all men know that we are disciples. Yeah. And if we have to love one another. John 13:35 says. Then he talks about the seventh is be obedient Christians. You have to listen to Christ. Then he talks about learn how to meet temptations. Temptation is not sin. Yet yielding to that is sin. You know what I mean? So through Holy Spirit, we have to fight the temptation, he talks about. And then he says, be a wholesome Christian. Our life, our appearance should show that we are attractive towards the God. And then leave above your circumstances. That's the all point I was going to leave above your circumstances. Whatever you have to leave above it, not below it. You should always thank God that we have everything, God. And thanks for giving me your time. You have a wonderful day. Nalla vadanai